Hi everybody, thanks for joining this call. As Elsa said, the first section of this is just to start to understand what is classification and why it's important in para sport and all the para sports. So we'll go through a little bit of the content, which is around classification explained, when does it take place, national classification versus international classification, the three steps of the classification process in para sport, who's involved, how you can support it as a coach or a national coach, and then obviously handing then over to Elsa around the Botcha sport classes so you can understand a little bit more around the functional presentation of athletes. So I'm hopeful that you'll get quite a lot out of this session. And as Elsa said, any questions, pop them in the chat box and we'll obviously answer these at the end of the session. So I think it's important to recognise that in para sport, classification is really important to try and create fair competition amongst our athletes. So we want to look at minimising the effect of disability on the outcome of competition. And that means that it decides who can and cannot compete in Paralympic sport. So those on a Paralympic pathway and groups athletes into sport classes for competition. And that depends on how much impairment an athlete has and how that impacts on their activity. And it's looked at very holistically. I'm going to ask Dom now to play a YouTube video. And this is a video that just explains classification. This is a link that can be sent to you so you can utilize this as a resource within your own national centers. The National Paralympic Committee for Great Britain has produced this classification video, and I think it's a really easy to understand video for you to watch. So Dom, are you able to play this video?
Classification is crucial to para sport. Without it, competitive sport is not possible or meaningful. It establishes who can and cannot compete and groups athletes into sport classes. Disabled people who are not eligible to compete at the Paralympic Games can continue to enjoy sport, but they are not on a Paralympic journey. The classification system of each sport is different, but its aim is always the same: to minimise the impact of someone's impairment on the outcome of competition. Classification might seem complicated, but so are people. No two para-athletes are completely identical. Athletes may look different to their competitors, as there is a spectrum of impairments in each class. To be classified, athletes must submit medical information, go through sport and impairment-specific tests, and they may be observed in competition. During the classification process, athletes must give their best effort and a true reflection of their impairment. Athletes can choose someone to accompany them during this process. To enter a national competition, the athlete must go through national classification, run by the sport's national governing body. This should mirror international classification as much as possible. To enter an international competition, the athlete must undergo international classification, run by the sport's international federation. This outcome always overrules national classification. Classifiers work in panels of at least two and make decisions together. They decide which class an athlete competes in. They are trained by the International Federation of that sport and must have relevant professional qualifications. For example, they could be a physiotherapist or an ophthalmologist. Intentional misrepresentation, where someone fakes their level of impairment, is cheating. If it's proven, athletes or staff can face a maximum 4-year ban. Comparing competition results, personal bests, or season bests on its own is not evidence that an athlete has been misrepresenting their impairment. An athlete may change class for a number of reasons during their career. This does not mean that they were misrepresenting their impairment before they changed class. Depending on the nature of their impairment, an athlete could be classified multiple times during their career. An international federation can put an athlete through the classification process again if it thinks the athlete may have been given an incorrect class. athletes may need to go through the classification process again when there are changes made to the sports classification rules. Classification isn't the key to success in parasport. Different factors that impact on performance include talent, training technique, and good coaching. Athletes have successfully won gold medals despite being considered amongst the most impaired in their class. For further information, please visit our classification page at paralympics.org.uk.
So I think that gave you a little bit of an insight into classification explained, that it's an ongoing process by which Paralympic athletes are placed in the most appropriate group for competing following an assessment of their impairments. And that's what classification evaluation and classification assessment is. But different sports obviously require athletes to do different things, such as propelling a wheelchair, rowing, throwing, all different aspects of sport activity. So it's really important that classification, to minimise the impact of impairment, must be sport specific. So Boccia has its own classification process and tests, but that follow three steps. So when does classification take place, or when would it take place? So there should be a structure at regional, national and international level. And that should take place prior to a competition on a club regional level, national level or international level. But international classification will always overrule a national classification. And there's a recommendation that athletes are nationally classified prior to competing in a national competition or an international competition where possible. National competition should mirror what happens in international classification. So the three steps that we're going to go through, then at national level, should mirror what happens at the international evaluation. Classifying at national level is a responsibility and should be led by national governing bodies, and international level by international federations such as BISFED. National classification serves to determine whether an athlete meets the sport's minimum eligibility criteria as early as possible in their career. And that's very helpful because we don't want athletes starting out in the sport who are actually non-eligible for a Paralympic pathway. That doesn't mean that they're not eligible to play in the sport, but obviously wouldn't be able to be eligible for a Paralympic pathway or national competition. There's three steps of classification when evaluating an athlete. We'll always consider these three questions when an athlete presents for classification evaluation. Do they have an eligible impairment for the sport? Does the athlete meet the minimum impairment criteria of the sport? And what class should they therefore compete in? We're going to go through these in a little bit more detail at each stage. The athlete evaluation that we've been referring to is where a panel will assess an athlete, and a sport only allocated through athlete evaluation by a trained classification panel. And this takes place before the sport competition. In some sports, athletes are required to be observed in competition. All Boccia athletes must be observed in competition in order to be given sport. Have 2 to 3 classifiers on each panel, and it's important to know who those people are and who's involved in the athlete evaluation. Class is a type of technical official, so it's like a judge, an umpire, a referee, a timekeeper, but they're specific to each Paralympic sport, trained and accredited by the IF, so BISFED. The reason there's 2 or 3 on a panel is because we should be reaching decisions by consensus. And that's therefore taking away bias of an individual. A typical classification panel to look at a physical impairment, such as in Boccia, often has a physio, may have a doctor, and will have a technical classifier. And this can be somebody who's a qualified coach, a biomechanic, or somebody who has skills and experience in the sport. And we look at administering a number of specific tests for Boccia that measure the athlete's impairment against our sport classification rules. So who can support an athlete? So the video explains that one person can accompany an athlete into classification evaluation. They should be somebody who understands the athlete, who knows a little bit about their health and their medical status, as well as a bit about their sport history. This could be a parent, this could be a carer, or even a coach at national level. If we get to international level classification, this should be somebody from the athlete's national body or national Paralympic committee that supports them. Very often, this is a head coach, a physio, or somebody similar. Anybody who's a minor, so somebody under the age of 16 or 18, or has an intellectual impairment, then they must have somebody with them to support the process. So let's look at the stages. The first stage, or step one, is does the athlete have an eligible impairment? Do they have a medical diagnosis that puts them into one of the six eligible impairments that IPC dictate? So these include impaired muscle power, impaired passive range of movement, limb deficiency, or tonal change such as hypertonia, ataxia, or athetosis. So these are the impairments that are eligible for BOCCIA. Why do we need medical information? Why is that important for us? So it's really important to confirm that an athlete has an eligible impairment to play BOCCIA within their Paralympic pathway or national pathway. Athletes are required to submit some form of letter or, in international terms, a certificate of diagnosis that confirms what their medical diagnosis is in advance of being assessed, because they must meet the six eligible impairments for BOCCIA. There are certain circumstances why athletes may need to require to submit further medical evidence, but this will be determined by the classification panels and the head of classification. So what's minimum impairment criteria? What does actually that mean? Which is stage two. So each of a sport's Paralympic classification rules will describe how severe an eligible impairment must be for an athlete to be considered eligible. And these are the minimum impairment criteria. So this forms part of the physical assessment of an athlete evaluation. So examples might include the level of amputation, how high somebody is, what level of limb deficiency they have, or the level of increased muscle tone or spasticity. It's sport specific. So it may be that an athlete meets the criteria for one sport but doesn't meet the criteria for BOCCIA. Just because an athlete is not eligible to compete in a sport, it does not mean or question the presence of a genuine impairment. It is just based on the sport ruling and the sport competition rules. Does the athlete meet the minimum criteria of the sport? So how do we assess this in an assessment process? So the physical assessment is led by the medical team, so the doctor and the physio. And these, in the case of BOCCIA, can look at gross motor movement. So how do they throw, wheelchair propulsion, what's their balance like, their posture, what range of movement do they have, are they coordinated movements? We might be needed to assess muscle strength, for example, in BC4s, and also look at things like spasticity and muscle tone. So it's a really holistic assessment to understand the big picture of how an athlete presents functionally. Which leads us to step three. So how do we determine which sport class an athlete competes in? So we use the information gained from the medical eligibility, step one. Step two, the physical assessment of the minimum impairment criteria, and then confirm this with a technical assessment carried out by the technical classifier. And this really looks at how does their activity limitation under simulated conditions affect their dexterity and grasp, upper limb or lower limb or trunk control, their coordination, and how do they throw, kick or release the ball. And that enables us to give them a provisional sport class to enter the competition. So it looks holistically, it really goes in depth into comparing the physical assessment findings and how that presents in a sporting activity. Observation assessment. So this is probably one of the final aspects of classification evaluation. All boccia athletes must be observed in competition to understand and assess the functional impact of their impairment on the sport activity. And this is the process that determines their final sport class. So this is almost the fourth step of classification evaluation in boccia. So we talked about sport class, we talked about the evaluation process, we've talked about all the components involved in that. So now we need to understand what is a sport class status. So what's the difference? And this indicates whether an athlete will be required to undertake a further evaluation in the future. For a new athlete, so somebody with a new status, is an athlete who's not yet been assessed or gone through that classification evaluation process. So this is the first time they've come to a competition, either nationally or internationally. We then have further status, which is review or review fixed date. So what do they mean? Review status, an athlete will need to go through a further evaluation classification, a minimum of approximately 12 months after their first evaluation. This could be somebody who's new to competition, not reached full musculoskeletal sport maturity, or has a medical condition that fluctuates or is progressive. Review fixed date is the same, however, there'll be a date on their review status that they will not be evaluated before. There's no need to see them before that date. Confirmed. So this is probably the final stage. So this is an athlete who doesn't need to go through athlete evaluation again. So the classification panel could be satisfied that their impairment and their minimum impairment criteria is such that they don't need to have a further evaluation. They're pretty stable and they're usually athletes who are well within the criteria for that sport class. The final one is those who we deem to be not eligible. So certain athletes will be unable to provide evidence that they have one of the six eligible impairments in the first place. Those who cannot compete in boccia, though, must never be inferred that they don't have an impairment. It's just not one of those six that we deem eligible for the sport. Certain athletes may be able to provide evidence that they have one of those. However, when assessed, fail to meet the minimum impairment criteria. So they may be eligible to compete in another sport subject to their rules, but obviously are not eligible and do not fit the criteria for boccia. If an athlete is found not to meet the sport's minimum impairment criteria, they are entitled to a second opinion. And within our classification rules, this may be the ability to challenge that evaluation through a protest or second panel evaluation. One of the questions we often get asked is how often are athletes classified? Athletes with sport status review will need to present for a second evaluation, a minimum of 12 months between athletes presenting for their first one. For athletes with sport status review fixed date, they will not need to present for a second evaluation until after that date is specified, so not before then. However, if an athlete's medical condition changes, it is the responsibility of the athlete to inform the sport and to ask for a reassessment at the next competition. This could be something linked to deterioration or similar. But due to the progressive nature of some impairments in the sport and their impact on certain activities, certain athletes may be required to be classified a number of times throughout their career. For example, if there are classification rule changes or if an athlete has a deteriorating condition. So how do you support athletes as a coach? And I think this is a question we often get asked. And I think just having a basic understanding of the classification process and what happens can be really helpful so that you can signpost athletes or supporting personnel to where they can get appropriate education, such as that video link or you referring to the rules. And this will help athletes to understand what the process is, what's involved, what to expect at each level, nationally or internationally. And this can be quite reassuring for athletes to know what's actually going to happen and what the process is. Maintaining that communication with athletes so that they can ask you questions and raise queries around it and share experiences as well, so that this isn't a taboo subject. Ensure athletes understand that they must try their best during the classification evaluation process. That's extremely important. I hope that you found that useful to understand more around the process of classification and how you can help or support your athletes. And I'll hand over now to Elsa Mathy, the BizFed Head of Classification, who's just going to take that into context for each of the BC1 to BC5 classes in Boccia. Thank you.